Morning. Well, welcome to the Village Chapel and welcome to our service of worship on this fourth Sunday of Advent. If you are visiting with us this morning, and I've met quite a bit of visitors, we certainly want to welcome you in the name of Christ. We're delighted that you're here. We do ask at least one thing, that you would register your attendance in what we call our visitor cards. You can find them in each of our friendship folders on every pew, and feel free to put that in the offering plate when it passes by during the offering. We certainly want to welcome our guest musicians today, the Carolina Brass. We're delighted to have them with us, and their names are printed in your bulletin. Certainly welcome them in the name of Christ. With next Sunday being Christmas, I want to just turn your attention to our services for the Christmas season. On Christmas Eve, we're going to have our children's Christmas pageant at 5 p.m. right here in the sanctuary. And then at 9 p.m. on Christmas Eve, we'll have our service of Holy Communion. And then on Christmas Day, we will have one service. It will be at 10 a.m., and it will include Holy Communion. And I do also want to mention for our parents that are planning to have their children in the Christmas pageant, our practice will be Wednesday, December 21st, from 3 to 4 o'clock or so, and then we're all going to retire over to Pinehurst Pizza for a time of fellowships. To have the children here at 3 o'clock on Wednesday. And then lastly, as you may know, the Village Chapel each year participates in the Toys for Tots ministry. That's a ministry of the Marine Corps Reserve. And not only do we collect toys here on our campus, we also, the Toys for Tots, that is, partners with our Angel Tree ministry. That is led, our local coordinator, Jerry Townley. And he reports that through the Toys for Tots ministry, with the help of the chapel, that almost 5,000 children received Christmas gifts in Moore County alone. So we praise God for that. We praise God for his leadership, and thank you for your generosity in helping make that possible here at the chapel. And now for the lighting of our Advent wreath.
Today, we relight the first three candles of the Advent wreath, the candles of hope, peace, and joy. Now, we light the fourth candle of Advent. This is the candle of love. Jesus demonstrated self-giving love in his ministry as the Good Shepherd. Advent is a time for kindness, thinking of others, and sharing with others. It is a time to love as God loved us by giving us his most precious gift. As God is love, let us be love also.
In the book of Deuteronomy, we find these words: "For the Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, the great God, mighty and awesome, who is not partial and takes no bribe, who executes justice for the orphan and the widow, and who loves the strangers, providing them food and clothing. You shall also love the stranger, for you were strangers in the land of Egypt." Deuteronomy 10:17-19. From the Gospel of John, we hear, "I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." John 13:34-35.
Let us pray together. The unison prayer is printed on page 5 of your bulletin. Teach us to love, O Lord. May we always remember to do first by Christ's footsteps, that we may know your love and show it in our lives. as we prepare for our celebration of Jesus' birth. Also, fill our hearts with love for the world, that all may know your love and the one with whom you sent your Son, our Savior. Amen.
And now for our call to worship. Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has come to his people and redeemed them. He has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he said through his holy prophets of long ago. Come, let us worship as we stand and sing our opening hymn, hymn number 188. Please be seated. And now let us make our humble confession to Almighty God with our prayer of confession. Let us pray. Most merciful God, We confess that we have sinned against thee, thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and what we have left undone. We have not loved thee with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of thy Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in thy will and walk in thy ways to the glory of thy name. Amen. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn to him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all of your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now we're going to ask for our children to come forward for our children's sermon.
It's so good to see you guys this morning. Today is the fourth Sunday in Advent. Can anyone remember this morning what candle we lit? What is the name of the candle that we lit this morning? You want to tell me?
Love.
Love. Yes, it's the love candle. And speaking of love, I need to know something from you. Is there a gift that you have received from someone, like your mom, your dad, Santa, your grandparents, that you just absolutely loved? What gift have you received that you just loved? Okay.
My papa.
Your papa. That's a great gift.
My Nana.
Your Nana, okay, good, good. Is there any other gifts that you've received from your family members that you've loved?
My doggy.
Your dog. That's a great one.
My dog and my 3DS.
All right. Very good. Okay.
My parents.
Your parents. Okay. Any other toys or anything?
Nothing.
Nothing. Well, that's all right. We can receive love and receive nothing. That's for sure. Okay.
My tablet.
Your tablet. All right. Well, you know what? These are awesome, awesome gifts. But you know what? There is a gift that all of us have received that is the greatest gift of love that has ever been given or will ever be given. Does anybody know what that gift is? All right, Gavin, tell us.
God.
God, Jesus, that's right. Jesus. Now, the Bible tells us, listen to this. The Bible tells us that God so loved the world, you and me, that he gave his only son, Jesus, that whoever believes in him will not die, but live forever with him in heaven. Isn't that a great gift? What an amazing gift of love to be given by God, our Heavenly Father. So Miss Vicki has a plan for you this Christmas. I want you to do something for me. As you're opening your Christmas gifts with your family this Christmas, I want you to remember that you have already been given the greatest gift of love that could ever be given from your Heavenly Father, and that is His Son, Jesus. Can you remember that this Christmas when you're opening your gifts? That would be wonderful. And we're going to pray before we go back to our seats. Is there anyone who would like to lead us in prayer this morning? I'm going to ask Mateo, will you do that for us this morning? So we're going to bow our heads and we're going to close our eyes and we're going to go to our Heavenly Father, okay?
Dear Lord, thank you for your one and only Son dying on the cross for our sins. And thank you for our families and friends. And please help all of those who need you in their life. And Lord, please protect us. And amen.
Amen. Okay, let's go back to our seats and Merry Christmas.
Good job. That was good.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. Again the Lord spoke to Ahaz, "Ask the Lord your God for a sign, whether in the deepest depths or in the highest heights." But Ahaz said, "I will not ask. I will not put the Lord to the test." Then Isaiah said, "Hear now, you house of David. Is it not enough to try the patience of men? Will you try the patience of God also? Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel. He will eat curds and honey when he knows enough to reject the wrong and choose the right. But before the boy knows enough to reject the wrong and accept the right, the land of the two kings you dread will be laid waste. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the book of Romans. Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle and set apart for the gospel of God, the gospel he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures regarding his son, who as to human nature was a descendant of David, and who through the spirit of holiness was declared with power to be the Son of God by his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Through him and for his name's sake, we received grace and apostleship to call people from among the Gentiles to the obedience that comes through faith. And you also are among those who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. To all in Rome who are loved by God and called to be saints, grace and peace to you from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the Gospel of Jesus Christ according to Matthew. This is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man and did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. "The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he had no union with her until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Our most gracious Sovereign, we invite you to come among us this morning in your grace and truth, to manifest your presence in our worship and fill us again with your spirit of expectation and hope. Holy Father, help us to receive with reverence and awe the miracle of the Incarnation, and to fathom your desire to be with us and with all of your creation. For you are our Emmanuel. You are our God and our Father, and you are with us. You indwell us, and we praise you. We laud and magnify thy glorious name, a name that you have revealed to us in the holy and precious name of Jesus. For he is our salvation. There is no other name given to us by which we are saved, that at his name every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that he is Lord, all for your glory. Loving and merciful God, we gladly bow to you now, and in exercise of our free will, we profess in one accord that Jesus is Lord, that he is our King and our Sovereign. Father, as you spoke through your holy prophets, help us also now to reject the wrong and choose the right. Give us a discerning spirit to choose righteousness in every conversation and in every decision, and to respond quickly to your call to belong and to be your holy people. Conceive in us by the same Holy Spirit that brought divine and royal life to a virgin, a life of obedience, humility, and peace. Help us to follow the good examples of both Mary and Joseph, who gave of themselves to be your vessels, bearing the gift of salvation to their generation and to the generations to come. Father, may we too bear the truths of Advent and Christmas for our generation and for this community. As you are the source of peace for all creation, we pray for peace in our world, peace on earth, and goodwill toward all men. We pray for peace in every nation, every home, and in every heart. We pray for the men and women who serve as your instruments of peace in our world, the men and women of our armed forces. Bless them all with the spirit of Christmas, and be to them the source of true merrymaking, especially those who will be away for the holidays. Father, multiply upon them your favor and your goodness 100-fold, and remind us to commit each one of them to prayer. Father, we pray for the poor and the homeless. We pray for the hungry and the fatherless. We pray for widows, and we pray for those in need, be it spiritual or physical. We pray especially for Tom Hurst, Lynn Cook, Braden Monaco, Ann Vanderwalk, Adelaide Gearing, Florence DeSandy, Judy Green, Ann Hannah, Alex Del Bueno. We pray for their healing, and we pray for their peace. In the name of Christ Jesus, who taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
See so many of you here with us this morning. Let us pray. Purify our conscience, Almighty God, by your daily visitation, that your Son Jesus Christ, at his coming, may find in us a mansion prepared for himself, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Well, here we are. On the Sunday before Christmas, with less than 2 weeks left of 2016, and with so many Americans looking back on this past year in extremely different ways, I think that's a fair statement, we could all probably use a vacation after what's been an unprecedented year of political division, domestic and foreign conflicts, class and racial unrest, and a general feeling of dissatisfaction with the way that things have been. In short, a tough, emotionally exhausting year all around. And now we're in the midst of the most stressful, viscerally demanding season of the year. And whether you're a Christian or not, at this time of the year, we're especially expected to be kind and considerate, generous and giving, joyful and cheerful, because Christmas is supposed to bring out the best in all of us. Does that sound familiar? Well, I can't provide anyone with a vacation this Christmas, not even for myself. But I can offer, for a few minutes this morning, a brief excursion into the world of someone who can teach all of us a thing or two about dealing with stress and about the real meaning of Christmas. Because he was there when it all began. I'm talking about Joseph, the father of Jesus and husband of Mary. Now, in Luke's gospel, which we'll read next Saturday evening on Christmas Eve, Joseph is only mentioned three times, and he's basically just there to observe the birth of his son. And then he just disappears from the pages of the Bible sometime when Jesus is between the ages of 12 and 30, with no explanation or even a farewell. Joseph has no recorded words in Scripture, no quotations, and he's not even mentioned in Mark's gospel. And I can think of only one Christmas carol that even includes his name, when Mary is in almost all of them. You get the idea that if they were to film a biography of Joseph, he wouldn't even get top billing. First would come Jesus, of course, and then Mary, with Joseph only in a supportive role. That's why we need Matthew's gospel, where today we see Joseph in his proper place as the head of the family and who keeps his family together, protects his wife and child in a dangerous world where they're hunted as criminals and forced to be refugees in a foreign country. Joseph is truly a man of courage and faith, and he leaves behind an example of faith for all of us, and a more important legacy, a son who will transform the world. So let's enter into his world for just a few moments as we put ourselves in the place of Joseph. As the story begins, he's probably 18 or 19 years of age. He's a working class laborer, and he knows just enough scripture to worship with the other men in the synagogue. And he's just starting out in life. He's poor because he is just starting out, but he's optimistic. He's got his whole life ahead of him, and he's engaged to be married and ready to start a family. And then what happens? He discovers that the young girl that he's engaged to is pregnant. He knows the child is not his, and being a law-abiding Jew, he knows what his legal options are. First of all, he would see this as a breach of contract situation. Mary was supposed to come into the marriage with her dowry, which is the property from her family, and her virginity intact. But along with a broken contract, Mary's pregnancy is also a capital crime. In Deuteronomy, it says that when an engaged virgin is found not to be a virgin, then, and I quote, "They shall bring the young woman out to the entrance of her father's house, and the men of the town shall stone her to death, because she committed a disgraceful act in Israel by prostituting herself in her father's house. So you shall purge the evil from your midst." Deuteronomy. But Joseph is unwilling to expose Mary to public disgrace, not to mention death. So he has decided to settle the matter quietly and release Mary from her engagement vow. So we already know that Joseph is a decent sort of guy before he's visited by the angel. Just because the law gives him the right to do something doesn't mean that he's going to do it. In other words, Joseph already understands that quite often there's a big difference between what's legal and what's right. Given his options, Joseph has chosen what's right. Now, Mary and her family are still disgraced, but at least Mary and her baby will be allowed to live. But then, Joseph is visited by an angel, and he must choose again. To stick with his righteous plan to break off the engagement, or to follow obediently the angel's command to take Mary as his wife and accept the child as his own. Imagine what must have gone through his mind before he decided what to do. How could he explain to his family and friends his decision to marry a girl who now has the legal status of a prostitute? What would you have done? And what would you have said to Joseph if he'd been your son, your brother, or your friend? At the very least, you probably would have tried to talk him out of it. How could Joseph have explained it? With the truth? How would that have sounded? Well, you see, there was this angel, and he explained it all. You see, Mary is still a virgin, even though she's pregnant. Would you have believed him? So, without, I think it's safe to say, a flood tide of family and community support, Joseph, in an incredible leap of faith, because he must not have understood any of this. It just didn't make any sense, and yet he follows the angel's command. And his first duty is to escort his now very pregnant fiance all the way to Bethlehem, their ancestral home, both of them being descendants of the house of David in the tribe of Judah, to answer another summons, this time from the Roman Emperor Augustus, to present themselves to be counted as taxpayers of the Roman Empire. The child of Mary and Joseph is born in Bethlehem. The child's cradle is a feeding trough for animals. And yet, shepherds, foreign dignitaries, angelic armies, the heavens themselves all declare the birth of the Savior of the world. But there's no time to celebrate. King Herod decides it's worth the deaths of hundreds of other babies to kill this newborn child. An angel warns Joseph to take his family and flee Bethlehem to avoid the slaughter and seek refuge in Egypt, where the Holy Family stays until King Herod is dead, which takes about 3 years. After which, Joseph takes his family back to Bethlehem, but is told before he gets there, again by an angel, that southern Judea isn't safe because the new king, a son of Herod, has just slaughtered about 5,000 Jews in Jerusalem. He's as bad as his father was. So the Holy Family has to take a wide detour to arrive back in Nazareth, where it all started. What a long, harrowing trip of faith that was. But it's just the beginning of the story. It's the story of a broken world being reconciled with its creator in the birth of a child. And in all of this, Joseph was a father to Jesus in every way. When the future marriage between Mary and Joseph was threatened, God spoke to Joseph, and Joseph obeyed even when it didn't make sense. When the life of Jesus was threatened, Joseph took charge of his family and protected that family even as refugees in a foreign country. Jesus could feel safe growing up with a father like this, who would sacrifice himself for the needs of his family, assuring his son that he need never be afraid, giving his son a living example of courage and love that Jesus would never forget, even as he showed that courage and love to all the world in his passion. And in his obedience to God's will, Joseph shows generations of parents ever since that great parenting isn't about having a great education or great wealth to give their children. It's about consistency of character in our service to God. Great kids have been raised by uneducated and poor parents, as Joseph and Mary probably were. It's our character that counts more than our cash in our obedience to God's will. So, on this last Sunday of Advent, think of what Joseph's obedience to the will of God meant, that he was chosen to be the earthly protector of God's Son, to ensure Jesus' spiritual training, and trusting God no matter what the consequences or whether it made sense. He didn't question God, but was completely obedient. May God give us grace to imitate Joseph's courage and obedience to God's commands through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And now, in closing, these are some lyrics written by a Presbyterian pastor who happened to graduate from UNC. Joseph, so we oft may think, from the scene must always shrink. But the word of God is clear. Joseph's part was very dear. Earthly fathers have their place, showing heaven's caring face. Let us, men, like Joseph be, serving God so faithfully. For this world will need to see what a father God will be. Just as Joseph played the part, so we too reveal God's heart. And through our Lord Jesus Christ, may all of us be blessed, everyone. And now let us stand and reaffirm our faith with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From this he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
or kneel to receive the benediction. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. To him be the glory in his church throughout all generations, both now and forevermore. Amen.